Hi there, this is Sherry Hayes with Mom Delights, also known previously as largefamily.com before it was hacked. And we're talking today about using the McGuffey readers. And I was talking with you about my beginning readers, how they're in the original McGuffey's pictorial printer, primer, and the first reader. Now, my child that's in the second reader, she does about the same thing, just a little different. As you can see, as the lessons progress, she likes to put rubber bands to hold the binding open so that she can do her lessons. They get a little more involved, not really any pictures anymore, relying more on text. The words are longer. You know, we have entangled, proceeded, mischievous, and so actually, she's in the second reader, but she's probably at about sixth grade level. So that gives you an idea. And let me grab her composition book here for a minute. Okay, here's her composition book. And I will show you basically at the beginning of the second reader, we were still doing illustrations. For the narration, she still was not confident to write them on her own. Now she can write a half a page on each. I'll show you this. She still likes doing the illustrations here. So she wrote and did an illustration for a lesson. This lesson was called A Pleasing Dialogue. I'm not sure exactly what that is about. I have her copy the word list still, and I also have her copy. She makes original sentences using, I have her use at least, I think, 8 words from her word list. And she copies a portion. This is a portion that she's copied. And over here, she has a written narration of the lesson. And, you know, she does some little misspellings. If I think they're really egregious, I'll go over them. I'll say, honey, did you see that you need to respell this? But mostly I always try to sandwich my criticism in between phrase. I was so happy with your sentences. You did misspell a few words, but you know, you're so clever when you write them. See, it's a sandwich. I have a praise, a criticism, and a praise. So that the last thing that they hear is the praise, but then they also see that they need to make some corrections. Some children are more sensitive than others. You'll know your child better than anyone else. Some kids like, oh, I did that wrong. Well, thanks for telling me. Other kids are like, how dare you? I can't say that I did anything wrong. I did the best I could. You know, got both sides. So you have to work with a child. You know how to do it. And probably, they're probably kind of like you. That's probably, if you just think how you would want it done, it helps. Okay, so I also have students at the higher levels. I have one who is in the fifth level of the revised. Now, after the second, I just showed you the second. Then I go to the revised versions. Now, the upper revised ones will have an occasional illustration, and they're all very nice. The vocabulary is increased. The sentence complexity, it increases as they go on. There are excerpts from Shakespeare and poets and you know, bards would say. All kinds of different prose and poetry that some of them that we've forgotten. But the wonderful thing about using the McGuffey's, okay, using McGuffey's at these levels are that the complexity of the sentence structure and the vocabulary all prepares them for reading classics for the rest of their lives. If they go on, I don't know, to be, you know, lawyers, doctors, whatever, no matter what type of literature they're going to read for the rest of their lives, they will never be at a loss because they will be so used to reading this type of material. This is the best preparation for college literature that you could give a child, is this right here, other than reading the classics themselves. This prepares them to understand any classic they're going to read. Along with, like, you might want to study the Greek and Latin roots of words, but in other languages, basically. But other than that, these are the best preparations for any SAT for vocabulary that you could think of, because they're going to be learning these complicated words in context. In context and how they were meant, and then there, and you know, I'm like, well, we like to use King Alfred's English to understand the etymology of how our language came to be. And it's a very engaging, wonderful book. I recommend it everywhere. I don't get any kickbacks for selling it or anything, but I just love that book. Lori White is the one that writes it. And she's a Christian and she homeschooled her kids. It's just an amazing book. If you can get a hold of it for your older kids, do it. But anyway, so I'll show you the fifth reader. I'm going to grab her composition book just a second. You would think I'd have this all laid out, huh? Okay, this is her book for the McGuffey's readers. And I will show you. Okay, so this is her copy work. She uses McGuffey. I taught her McGuffey's script using the revised McGuffey's readers. I'll have to show you how I did that. But anyway, so here's some copy work. Here are some sentences. She's supposed to take each vocabulary word and put it in an original sentence. One of her sentences. They were both distracted, and so they collided. They were precipitated all day and long through the night. I'm sorry. There was neither sight nor sound of the reinforcements. The corps was a large body of men looking indestructible. The reserve was almost depleted. So, you know, this was from a little girl who's 13. Pretty good, huh? So, I know I brag on my kids. I like them, all right? All right. This is her narration that she's written. I think these are more sentences. This is the narration. Over here, she has a Harvey's grammar lesson. And I'll be talking about that grammar in a little bit, but... so she puts this in the same notebook. I also have a child in the sixth reader. And the sixth grader, when you put it to the test, I put these things to the test. The sixth grader is actually what we would consider graduate level in college today. The excerpts from different writers are just, I mean, there are actually arguments in front of the Supreme Court that are included in here. You can imagine that. We've got some ancient history. Let's see. Antony over Caesar's dead body. Interesting. They don't have, in the sixth reader, they don't have the vocabulary. This is the end of a lesson. There's no vocabulary here, no definitions. Sometimes they'll go over what the history was for during the lesson or some background. So what I have her do, the child that's in this book, I have her pick out five interesting words from the reading and find definitions for them. Then I have her do the copy work and do a narration. So that's what she does for that. And the amazing thing is that even though I haven't really required any other type of writing except for notebooking pages, my children, as they've gone through the McGuffey's readers, are amazing writers. They spell well. I have creative children, okay? So spelling has not always been easy to teach. But the children that I've put through the McGuffey's readers, they spell well. They write. Their sentence mechanics are amazing because they understand it. And it's interesting. They can write anything I give them. If I say, here's an essay, here's the basic, how you do it, and they understand it and they'll just write. I mean, it's like falling off a log for them because we've gone through this. For the older girls, I only give them one lesson a week, and the McGuffey's, they have other things they do. For little girls, I might give them two lessons a week. But just the practice, and like I had talked about, it's just constant reintroduction, reinforcement, reintroduction, reinforcement until the language just becomes part of who they are, and writing is not a chore. It's just easy to do. It's something, I can write that, no problem. Of course, we use some dictation and stuff like that, and I'll talk to you more about, you know, like the spelling part and everything. But, well, that's all the time I've got now. We'll do it another time. Bye-bye.